Morning, everybody. So thank you for your presence. We have a lot of visitors with us. There's too many, in fact, to point out everyone who's with us. So if you see someone you don't recognize, make sure that you grab them and thank them for worshiping with us this morning. I do want to point out one visitor, and her name is Catherine. There she is. She works, you might as well wave because I'm talking about you. She works at the Elephant Sanctuary just up the road here, and she's going to be there working this summer. So she'll be with us, hopefully, if we're all nice to her, here with us this summer when while she's worshiping with the Lord's people. So we're thankful for her and for all the visitors that we have with us. It's a great privilege. We hope that she'll come back if you have opportunity. At 6 o'clock, we'll meet again. We'll have a sermon from my friend Brent, who was going to lead singing this morning, but I almost said passed the buck. That's not the right way, but he just handed the ball over to Colby, who did a great job with last minute notice. So be here at 6 to hear Brent preach to us for our fourth Sunday special. And then, of course, Wednesday night, we meet again for midweek Bible study. The adult class, we're studying Isaiah, and then Jesse's teaching them something, Acts, he says, in the class in the fellowship area. I want to make a couple of quick announcements, if you'll permit me, before we get into the sermon. I know Colby mentioned a couple of these, but I want to just hammer them home. One is our Vacation Bible School, which starts next week in 8 days, in fact, starting on Monday of next week, August 4, 5, and 6, at 7 o'clock. I want us all to make sure that we invite everyone that we know, and we get as many young people here as we can, and older people as well, of all ages, because we have classes for all ages. We've got some great speakers teaching the adults and teaching the teens. We have great teachers here. They're going to be teaching all of the kids' classes. So we hope it will be, we think it will be a great Vacation Bible School. We've got a really good theme, we think, and everybody's ready to go, except for the decorations, which we'll be working on this week. So that's the next announcement. This Saturday, about 9 o'clock or so, if you're able to make it, we're going to gather here and try to work on these decorations and get everything put up and get ready for Vacation Bible School. So if you can join us Saturday morning until early afternoon or so, or just as long as you can, really, just that would be great. If you can help us, you're ready for that. One more announcement, and that is August the 24th is our annual Friends and Family Day, our annual homecoming Sunday. We have a big goal, as we have every year. I remember our first year we did this, my first year in 2012, our goal was 100, which would have been about double what we had at the time, and we ended up with, I think, 166 or so. And my second year, last year, our goal was for 200. We had over 250. This year, our goal is just, I don't want to see a single seat without a body in it. So our goal is a full house. But secretly, I'll be okay if we have to bring in extra chairs. But let's at least set that first goal and meet that, a full house. So that means invite all your friends, invite all your family, invite your neighbors, invite your mailman, your dentist, your worst neighbor. It doesn't matter who it is. Just say to them, this is the one time. If you come, just one time, come. And then if they come, our motto is, we'll get them to come back. And maybe keep coming back. So that's the announcements that I have for you. That's August the 24th. Please make plans, if you can, for that. Now I want to start this morning by reminding us of what our theme is for 2014. That might be a hit scratchy. You may not know that we had a theme, but it's something that I do as I plan out the sermons year by year, and I try to look at an overarching theme for that year's worth of sermons. And it's not something that we hit on hard every single week. It's just something that I might touch on in the middle of a sermon every week, or every now and then devote a sermon to it. But it started in 2012, where we had this core nucleus of Christians who've been worshiping here a long time, and then a great influx of people who had just started coming here. And so our goal in 2012, our theme was growing together. It was something I touched on here and there. We did sermons about it here and there, growing together. Last year, our theme was you need Jesus. And it was a statement that was repeated over and over. It devoted whole sermons to it, or just a point here and there, or just a statement here and there, reiterating that theme, you need Jesus. In fact, I think the first sermon I preached last year was entitled, Without Him. And we need Him. Now this year, our theme, if you haven't caught on, here's a statement that I've been making every now and then in sermons. It is rising to a new level of Christianity. Our theme for 2014 is personal growth. Not numerical growth, not growth by getting a whole bunch of bodies here, but the people that we have here who worship with us regularly, personally growing in their faith with Jesus Christ, growing on their journey with Jesus Christ, rising, as that statement goes, and I'll say it again, I'm sure, in the sermon, to a new level of Christianity. Where are you on your Christian journey? You can always go a little higher. And so that's our goal for this year. I want us to use that goal as the basis for our sermon this morning. Now that whole idea takes us to our title this morning. Our title is, What's Left? Now that makes me think of a conversation between Jesus and a person very famously. Open your Bibles to Mark chapter 10, and let's read verses 20 through 22. Mark chapter 10, verses 20 through 22. Jesus speaking with the person we know of as the rich young ruler. That's a pretty vague statement. We really don't need to know a lot about him. Based on this conversation, we learn enough about him to help us in this sermon. Mind you, our discussion is, our title is What's Left. The idea is growing and advancing, not getting complacent. Listen to the conversation in Mark 10, 20 through 22. Now, we're starting in the middle of this. It starts with this rich young ruler running to Jesus and saying to him, falling at his feet and saying, Master, what must I do to inherit eternal life? So, he asks the right question. He goes to the right source. He clearly has the right motive. What must I do to have eternal life? Jesus essentially says to him, just before we start the text here, he says, you're a Jew, keep the law. You don't commit adultery, don't steal, don't kill, honor your father and mother. Just keep the commandments of the law. You do that and you'll be fine. This person says, verse 20 of Mark 10, he answered Jesus and said, Master, all these things I have observed from my youth. Now you read different accounts, maybe even different translations. It words it slightly differently. Essentially, it's this. Master, all these things I've been doing. Don't read it as though he's saying, whew, okay, good, all these things I've done, and then he walks away. No, he doesn't. He's clearly exasperated. He's clearly frustrated with himself. He asks the question, what am I missing? I've been doing all of these things, Master. Verse 21. In fact, Matthew's account, by the way, in Matthew 19, adds that extra question, what am I lacking? Verse 21 of Mark 10 here. Then Jesus, beholding him, loved him, and said to him, there's a whole different sermon right there, one thing you lack, go your way, sell whatever you have, give it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven, and come, take up the cross, and follow me. Listen to Jesus' advice. He says, I see it, I know what it is, I know what you're lacking. And then he tells him what he's missing. Verse 22, though, and he, the young man who's speaking with Jesus, he was sad at that saying, and went away grieved, because he had much possessions. You see, this person had been doing everything he thought he was supposed to be doing. And on paper, he had been doing everything he was supposed to be doing. He was keeping those commandments that Jesus said. You got all the details right. You crossed every T, you've dotted every I. You've done everything you're supposed to do in a technical sense. Yet still, Jesus could read it on his mind. And he even says it to him, I'm lacking something. Jesus says, yes, you are. Here's what you're lacking. Now catch this. This just blows my mind every time I read it. Do you ever notice this? Jesus says to him, you're lacking something, and his solution is for him to take something away. Does that make any sense? I mean, we've heard people, you watch infomercials and things, that have the whole spiel with the person who's missing something, and the guy will say, you're missing something, you need this for $19.95, whatever it is. It's always, you're missing something, so let me add something that you need. Are you having trouble sleeping? Here's what you're missing, a warm glass of milk and counting to 100 sheep or whatever. You're missing something, let me fill in what you're missing with something additional. That's not what Jesus does here. It defies grammar. He says you're lacking something, so you need to get rid of some things. What am I lacking, Jesus? Too much possessions. That doesn't make any sense, but you have to keep reading. Sell those possessions, come follow me, and you will find treasure in heaven. Again, look at verse 21. Listen to Jesus carefully. Jesus beheld him, loved him, and said to him, one thing you lack, go sell whatever you have, give it to the poor, and you shall have treasure in heaven. How will I have that, Jesus? Come, take up your cross, and follow me. What is this rich person actually lacking? Do not take this. Do not dumb this down and water it down to be Jesus' anti-rich people. No. This is Jesus being anti-covetous people. This person loved his money at least as much as God. Maybe not even more. Let's not presume. We don't know this guy. Maybe he loves his money just as much as God, but he certainly doesn't love it less than God. And Jesus calls him on it. Sell your possessions and come follow me. And what does he do? He goes away sad. Proving Jesus right. You love your things more than me. Do you want to rise to a new level of Christianity? You've got to let go of whatever it is that's holding you back. Whatever weights are dragging you down, you've got to let go of them. Take up your cross and follow him. That's what he calls for us to do. But so many people, at the sound of that statement, will go away from him. And they'll go away sad. Why? I mean, you'd think if you're going to go away from Jesus, you're going to go away at least satisfied with yourself, content and believing that you're right and he's wrong. But this person, like so many people, goes away sad. knowing he's wrong, but just not strong enough, not with the willpower enough, not loving Jesus enough to let go of whatever it is that's holding him back. Now, let's pause here. Let's pause at the exact moment that Jesus says, and come follow me. We know what happens next. We know he walks away. Just for a moment, just suppose, maybe he did it. Now, we know he did, but let's just pretend that this rich young ruler did not, in fact, walk away from Jesus. Let's pretend that this was a person who actually did what the Master said. He let go of all of the things that he loved more than Christ, in this case, his possessions, and he goes to follow Jesus. Now, what do you think this rich young ruler's rich young friends would have thought about that? You mean you're giving away all of your gold? You're giving away all your fancy clothes? You've got all these hired servants? You're letting it all go? If you let go of all these things, if you let go of that, if you let go of this, if you let go of that, what's going to be left? What will you have left to yourself? What's left? Title of our sermon. Let's ask that question. If I do shed all the things that I don't need, all the things that may be pretty, they may be spacious, they may be wonderful to behold or great to feel or whatever, all those things in the world, if I actually just got rid of all those things that hold me back and prevent me from growing spiritually as he wants me to, if I actually shed those things, what would be left? What's left? What's left is the kind of Christian Christ wants me to be. And that's our sermon this morning. We have a few points to consider. But before we do, I want to extend this introduction to help make this point. Jump over to James chapter 1. We're doing things a little differently. If you're familiar with the way I tend to preach, it's usually a short introduction, a long points, and a short conclusion. We're making a big introduction in a short set of points. But look at James chapter 1, 23 through 25. Our question is, what's left? How do I know what I've got to shed to have what is left be left? You know what I mean? How do I do that? Well, have you got, and I'm not looking at anybody, have you got some weight that you're trying to get off? You know, it's the summertime, you want to look nice. Are you trying to lose a little weight? I'm not looking at anybody. I'm just trying as hard as I can to look around. If you do, what's the first thing you do? You close all the doors, shut all the blinds, make sure no one's around, and then you stand in front of the mirror. Shamefully, tearfully, you look in the mirror and you say, that's got to go. That's too much of that. What happened to these? Why? Okay, read James 1, 23 through 25. For if any hears the word and is not a doer, he's like a man who beholds his natural face in a mirror. And he beholds himself and goes his way and straightway forgets what manner of man he was. He looks in the mirror, he sees what he is, and then he forgets it and goes on believing what he wants himself to be. Foolish, in other words. Verse 25. But whosoever looks into the perfect law of liberty and continues therein, he's not a forgetful hearer, he's a doer of the work, and this man will be blessed in his deed. He contrasts, James does, two kinds of people. The one who needs to change. He's got some fat to burn. He looks at himself in the mirror and says, good looking, and walks away. Knowing he's not, but believing himself to be, refusing change. The other person looks at himself in the mirror and says, okay, I got to cut this, I got to cut that, I've got to trim this, so that when I next time look in the mirror, it'll be more of this and not so much of that, right? So James says here, if you will look in the Word of God, look in the mirror of the Word of God, it will show you your reflection. Not your reflection of what you are. It will show you a reflection of what Christ knows you can be once you've risen to the level of spirituality he wants you to achieve. So look in that perfect mirror of the Word of God and you will see a Christ-like picture looking back at you. But then you look down and you think, this does not match up. That's why you get on your diet. That's why you start cutting up this and cutting up that and trimming this away and trimming that. And when you do that, what's left? What is left? Except the kind of Christian Christ wants us to be. One more point, and then we're going to start the actual points of the sermon. It is a sin. Big word. It is a sin to stop growing with Jesus Christ. What is his commandment? He said it to the rich young ruler. He says it to us. Take up your cross and look pretty. Stand there. Take up your cross and finish it, please. Follow me. That implies motion. It implies movement. It implies one foot in front of the other. You're constantly walking. What do we sometimes do? We will get rid of the things that we need to get rid of. We'll pick up that cross. We'll take two steps. Ooh, this is heavy. And we'll just pause. We'll sit. And we'll say, you go on ahead, I'll catch up. And then usually we don't. Because if we show no indication that we want to catch up, he's just going to keep on walking. Now if we say, hey, wait up, I'm coming, he'll turn around, he'll grab us with his hand, he'll pull us up to him. But if we just sit, if we just park it and let him keep on going, he's going to keep on going. And if we don't follow him, we're left behind. We all know it's a sin to turn back. Jesus says it repeatedly. You can't be plowing and look back or you'll plow right off the road. But it's just as much wrong to just stop moving, to stop growing, to stop advancing. And so that's our goal, to get rid of the weights that are holding us back, that's Hebrews 12:1, and start running the marathon with endurance, that race set before us. Now how do we do that? What have we got to shed? What have we got to lose? Here's our sermon. Four things these are that hinder personal growth. Take away foolishness. What's left? Take away arrogance. What's left? Take away fearfulness. What's left? Take away selfishness. What's left? But the kind of Christian Christ wants us to be. First of all, take away foolishness. My dad always would say to me, probably still does if I'm paying attention, which I don't do enough. When I was a kid, he would always say to me, cut the silliness out. Enough of that. Enough of that foolishness. Don't stop being so silly. Now, if you know me at all, if you spent 30 seconds with me, silliness, pretty good descriptor of who I am. So it's almost like that's my way of rebelling. Some people do motorcycles and cigarettes. I just told a lot of jokes because my dad constantly would say, stop being so silly, stop being so foolish. Because he would look at me cracking jokes at the dinner table or staying up late to play Nintendo or whatever it was, stop being so silly all the time. Well, I can't help it. It's just who I am. How does my Father in heaven view silliness? What does he say is foolishness? You know what it is? It is the planning of people that doesn't include God. You want to grow personally? Here's what a lot of people say. I've got it all figured out. I know what I'm going to do, how I'm going to grow, how I'm going to adapt, and we forget the recipe book is right here. And we don't even turn to it. We get it all up here, and we think, here's what I'm going to do. And God says, no, don't be silly. You can't do this without me. Let me give you an example. Look at 3:19. 1 Corinthians 3:19. You want to do your planning without God? God's going to say you're being silly. 1 Corinthians 3:19, Paul writes, for the wisdom of this world, worldly wisdom, is foolishness with God. Because it is written, he quotes from Job, here he says he takes away the wise in their own craftiness. Whenever I think I've got it all figured out, whenever I've talked myself into whatever I'm going to do, it's all about me, my plans, my mission, my goals, and I don't include God, I don't turn to his word and follow his will, he says, you're being foolish. Watch what I'm going to do. And he takes me and puts me where he wants me. That's what Paul says when he quotes from Job. He takes the foolishness of the world, laughs at it, and says, now here's what you're really going to do. You're not going to do that. You're going to do what I want you to do. This is my will for you. Now you might resist it, you might rebel against it, but his will is going to be for you, whether you follow it or not. He says, here's your will. Here's what I want you to do. You ever see a mother dog pick up a puppy and carry it where she wants it by the nape, you know, in the back of the neck, and the puppy just goes limp, you know? So now I'll watch. Because I'm so weird, there's the little webcam of some Washington, D.C. animal shelter. And sometimes I'll turn it on to watch the puppies bite and poop all over the floor and stuff. It's just good just to have on in the background, because I have to have something on in the background. And sometimes you'll see the dog pick up the other dog, and this dog will want to run over here. And nope, I'm going over here. Why? Because that's where the parent wants you to go. God says, here's what you're planning. You want to go this way. No, you're going to go this way. Your plans are foolishness to him. Here's where I want you to go. So stop as you're trying to grow personally, thinking you're going to do it without God. You need the Lord to guide and plan for you. And then it's up to us just to follow his will. Stop trying to do things your way. Take away foolishness. What's left? What's left is wisdom. Following the will of God. And if you do that, you will grow spiritually, personally. Number two, take away arrogance. Listen to the master tell a story. Open your Bibles to Luke chapter 7. Let's start with the setup, and then we'll go into the story. Look at Luke 7. Let's start in verse 37. Take away arrogance, the feeling that you're better than somebody else, and you'll grow. Luke 7, let's start in verse 37 to get the context. And even now, we're starting in the middle of it, but roll with it. Luke 7, 37, and behold, a woman in the city which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat at meat in the Pharisee's house, she brought an alabaster box of ointment. Pause. Context. this Pharisee, this person who naturally has been untrusting of Jesus and who he is, invites Jesus to his house, okay? This woman, described as a sinner, knows Jesus is going, loves Jesus, wants to worship Jesus, takes this alabaster box of ointment, let's call it a jar of perfume in modern phraseology. Now continue verse 38 of Luke 7. And stood at Jesus' feet, behind him weeping, and began to wash his feet with tears, and then wiped them with the hairs of her head, and kissed his feet, and anointed them with the ointment. Now, when the Pharisee which had bidden Jesus saw it, he spoke within himself, mind you, not words out loud, thoughts in his mind, and thought to himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, he would have known who and what manner this woman was that touches him, for she's a sinner. You see his mistake? It's twofold. He thinks bad of other people, and he assumes Jesus thinks like him. Stop thinking people think like you. You think like you. We don't want anybody else thinking like you. Let's all just think like ourselves. But this Pharisee thinks he must think like I do. And if he really was a prophet, he would know how disgusting this sinner woman is. He wouldn't want her or want him washing his feet with her hair. Keep going. Verse 40. And Jesus answering said to him, Simon, that's the Pharisee's name, I have somewhat to say to thee. Now there is no gulp in the text, but I feel like if this guy has any sense of what's about to happen, he's probably gulping. Because Jesus, when he turns, says, I got something to say to you. And all he says is, Master, say on. But I imagine if he knows what's coming, there's a gulp following that statement. Jesus speaks verse 41. Once upon a time, there was a certain creditor which had two debtors. One owed him 500 pence, the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me, therefore, which of them did he love the most? Simon answered and said, I suppose that he to whom he forgave most. And Jesus said to him, you have rightly judged. And he turned to the woman and said, Simon, do you see this woman? I entered into your house. You gave me no water for my feet, but she's washed my feet with her tears and wiped them with the hairs of her head. You gave me no kiss, the customary greeting when you enter a person's home. But this woman, from the time I came in, has not ceased to kiss my feet. My head with oil you didn't anoint, which was a way of showing honor to an honored guest. You didn't do that. But this woman has anointed my feet with ointment, with, by the way, a box of very expensive ointment. Wherefore I say to thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven, for she loved much. But to whom little is forgiven, who has little forgiven? The one who loves little. That's this Pharisee. You have sin as well, but because you love little, how much is God going to forgive him? Little. But because this woman who sinned greatly, has loved greatly, has chosen to serve greatly, Jesus says she's going to be forgiven greatly. Because the bigger the debt, the bigger the forgiveness, the greater the blessing, is it not? Now forgiveness is forgiveness is forgiveness, but if you've got debt this much and you're forgiven, that's a big forgiveness. The Pharisee, this much debt. But how much of it is forgiven? None. Because he chose not to be forgiving. He chose not to be loving. He chose to be arrogant. He chose to look down on someone who was not like him. You invite me to your house, but you don't do any of these little things that common courtesy dictates. It's just like people, if I may get on a soapbox, who call themselves Christians, but they never enters into their mind that they have responsibilities that they have to fulfill as servants of Christ. I said it last week. Let me repeat myself. You are not saved to sit back. You are not taken away from Satan and free from your sins so you can now take it easy and relax and retire. You retire when you go to heaven. In the meantime, he saved you, he freed you so that you could work for him. But a lot of Christians have this idea, I'm saved. I'm better than that person down there. I'm better than that person down there. I'm better than that person because they're all going to hell. I'm going to heaven. I can sit back in my easy chair and I can relax. That's not what Christianity is. Take away arrogance. Take away contempt. Take away your feeling that you're superior to some other people. And what's left? A desire to serve and to help and to reach out. If this Pharisee, this story Jesus tells, and the whole point is not about the woman. It's about the Pharisee. If he loved like she did, he would have done, he would have acted, he would have invited Jesus, he would have been good to the sinner. He would have helped other people. Take away arrogance. What's left? A heart that loves and seeks to help anyone. When you do that, you grow closer to Christ. Number three, take away fearfulness. The big reason, in my opinion, that people don't take that next step in their Christian faith is just because they're afraid. The reason they don't rise to the level of Christianity Christ expects them to is because they're just too scared. If you become a Christian at age 15, I think I was 14, about to turn 15, so let's round number 15. You become a Christian at 15, let's say you die at 85, and just pull that number out of a hat. That is 70 years of Christianity. If you are just as faithful at 15 as you are at 75, there's a problem. If you still make the same mistakes at 15, the same ones you make at 75, there's a problem. If you have know just as much about the Bible at 15 as you do at 75, there's a problem. If you read your Bible, if you attend just as much, if you do all these Christian things at 15 that you do at 75, unless you are a savant, and at 15 you are a wonder Christian, a super Christian, odds are you have some growing to do. But if you don't do any growing by the time you die, don't you agree there's a problem there? But yet, there are a lot of Christians who've been Christians a long time, and they act like it's college professors. They get tenured. I've been a Christian a long time, so what I say goes. No, what the truth is goes. Maybe you need to go read the truth. It doesn't matter how long you've been a Christian, but a reason that they're not at whatever age they are, how many years they've been removed from becoming a Christian, the reason they've not grown is because they've been afraid. They sat down, they formed a little groove, they got comfortable in it, and then want to step out of it. Now listen to my Lord. Open your Bibles to Isaiah 43 and look at verses 1 through 3. Isaiah 43, verses 1 through 3. Now I'm going to read this. I'm a King James guy from birth, but I'm going to read this in the English Standard Version, so it might be different or it might be the same. Isaiah 43, 1 through 3. Listen to the Lord as he talks to his people, as he talks to us. But now thus says the Lord, he who created you, O Jacob, he who formed you, O Israel. Fear not. This is what it says. Fear not, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name. You are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And through the rivers, they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flame will not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel. That is a father saying to a scared child in the middle of the night, I'm here. I'm going to get you through it. It's going to be okay. Why don't we grow individually? Because we're scared. Why are we scared? Our Father is holding our hands. He's trying to lead us to the next level of our Christianity. Let me just give you an example before we move to the last point. I am a very, you know this, if you know me at all, socially unadept, not good socially person. Grammar not good either. Not a good socially skillful person. If you lock me in an elevator with a person who likes to chit-chat, I'm breaking the hatch and I'm clapping the little pipes to get out, okay? I'm not good with conversations and with having to deal with people on a one-on-one or a one-on-100, whatever, basis. It's not my strong suit. But I knew when I first became a Christian, I'm going to have to overcome that. And when I certainly became a preacher, I knew I've got to overcome that. It's hard. You get scared, but you just force yourself to do it. Christopher Faulkner. Doesn't everybody love Christopher? Hard worker, everything. Wasn't a Christian when I first met him. Were you working on my house? He was working on my house right down the road when I first met him. And I thought to myself, here's a guy, not a Christian. Now, I've got a job as a Christian, not a preacher, as a Christian to go to that person to try to help him find Christ. So I walked up to him. It was an awkward 2-minute conversation, but I did it. I did it. I did that thing that was hard, even though I was terrified, but I had to do it, and I did it. And I'm not taking any of the credit for why he's here, but I'm glad he's here. He's one of my dearest friends, and he's my brother in Christ now, because at least one person, among many others, was scared and did it. Christ will hold your hand, and if he has to, he will pull you up to that next level. But if you're scared, you'll never reach out and take it. Don't be scared. If you're not scared, if you let it go, what's left? A child of God who's ready to do, ready to go, ready to serve. Last point, number 4, take away selfishness. Let me give you a text you're probably very familiar with. 1 Corinthians 13, 4 and 5. Charity, my Bible says, King James, agape love is the meaning of it. Your Bible might just say love, but it's agape love. It's the love of a servant. It's the love of one who gives, thus charity, suffers long and is kind. Charity envies not, it wants not itself, is not puffed up, does not behave itself unseemly, does not seek its own, is not easily provoked, does not think evil. We are supposed to be a loving people. What does that have to do with selfishness? Listen to his description of loving people. Love is kind. The word means useful. What can I do for you? Not selfish. Not envious. Them, why not me? None of that. Not arrogant. Those people are just, but I, no, none of that. not rude. Maybe, as my mother would say, if it's not nice, it doesn't need to be said. That's not loving people. Or at least that's supposed to be how loving people are. Not self-seeking. That's our word, selfish. Not quick-tempered. Do little things set you off? Stop. Not assuming the worst in people. You don't know what they're thinking. You don't know what's going through their day. Just think the best in them, and you'll have a better half of your life. All those things fall under the banner of agape, charity, love, the giving of oneself. A person who gives is going to say, how can I help? The person who gives is going to wonder, what can I do to help this person grow? And when you're thinking of them, you'll be yourself growing. Take away selfishness. What is left? A life of love willing to serve. Now, conclusion. You look in the mirror of the Word of God. It tells you what you can be, not what you are. It tells you what you need to trim. But like the rich young ruler, you've got to make the hard choices and start cutting. Take away foolishness, arrogance, fear, and selfishness, and you'll have a servant ready to serve Christ. I said this in class on Wednesday night, and then I'm going to be done. You become a Christian. You start out at the very bottom. You become a Christian. You sit on a hill of knowledge. The amount of knowledge that you needed to become a Christian. You're on a hill. Congratulations. Don't get arrogant at the people who are below you. You're a Christian. It's your obligation to pull them up to you. But you're also a new Christian. There's a whole other hill of Christians who've been Christians longer, who've grown longer. They're up here, and they're beckoning you down here. Wish I had this on PowerPoint. To come up to them. So you need to not be arrogant to them, not be selfish about yourself, not be fearful, but reach up and take them, and they will pull you up. And they'll do that by encouraging you. It sounds like nagging sometimes. It's just old-fashioned agape encouragement. Hey, why don't I see you on Sunday nights? Why don't I see you on Wednesday nights? Why aren't your kids in Bible school? Have you given of your means like Christ wants you to give? Are you forgiving that person who every time you see them, just get all mad? I'm not mad at you. This is why preachers get fired, by the way, because they start trying to help grow. This is why friends get broken, because friends try to help them grow. And we want to sit in our grooves, get all comfortable, and not take the next step. Let's climb up that hill. That's what Christ wants us to do. It begins, though, with your becoming a Christian. Are you a Christian? Let me rephrase that. Are you a baptized believer in Jesus Christ? Do you recognize that He is the Son of God who died and was risen for your salvation? If you do, change your mind, be ready to serve Him. That's called repentance. It's commanded by Jesus in 13:3. Then tell the people about Him. That's commanded by Jesus in Matthew 10:32 and 33. Then be immersed in water. Why? Because it's commanded by Jesus, Mark 16:16. You reenact the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus, Romans chapter 6, and then you put on a new man, Romans chapter 6, or the whole chapter. And you can start walking in newness of life. You can start walking with your sins taken away. Acts 2:38. And then, only then, you can start growing as a Christian. If we can help you become a Christian, if we can help you grow as a Christian, let us know how. If you need to step out, we'll reach you. Right now, as we stand and sing.